You're feeling big and bad, and you want to let everyone know that you are not to be messed with. How do you do it? You declare your hood, and you make sure they know to stay out of it. Welcome to Learning with Sprayberry, where our goal is to make social studies fun, easy, and educational. If you enjoy social studies, U.S. history, or just learning, take a second, hit that subscribe button, and ring the bell so that you don't miss anything. Now that we got the begging for subscribers out of the way, let's hit up today's topic. We're covering up the time when the United States established its no-go zone for Europe. Coming off the heels of the War of 1812, the U.S. is feeling pretty good. We just beaten the world's most powerful military and wanted to establish ourselves as a power equivalent to any European superpower. To find out how that war went, check out my video series on that. Anyway, our plan consisted of laying down the law and setting up some boundaries. While we might have been one of the first colonies to successfully kick off our colonial oppressors, many colonies in Latin America are starting to look at our success as an inspiration. Latin American countries are beginning to kick out their Spanish colonial leaders and found their own countries. In 1823, James Monroe, in his State of the Union address, introduced a new idea. We owe it, therefore, to candor and to the amicable relations existing between the United States and those powers to declare that we should consider any attempt on their part to extend their system to any portion of this hemisphere as dangerous to our peace and safety. With the existing colonies or dependencies of any European power, we have not interfered and shall not interfere. The policy of the U.S. was essentially, if you got colonies, you can keep them. But if you're trying to get new ones or take back old ones, we're not going to play on that. I said this was a new idea, but this same concept had been around since 1783. George Washington brought up the idea of isolationism when he released his farewell address. He warned the United States to stay away from permanent foreign entanglements. The Monroe Doctrine is essentially a continuation and a step up from Washington's initial idea. For more information, check out that video. So, how well does this big and bad statement go over? For the most part, pretty well. Let me throw some caveats on that. Most of the world didn't care that we told them to stay out. To be perfectly honest, the U.S. neither had the Army or the Navy to enforce this policy. If anybody in Europe actually tried to challenge this, we couldn't have backed it up. Latin American countries were thankful for the support given by the United States, but many of them had absolutely no delusions that the U.S. could protect them. In fact, many of them knew that the U.S. couldn't do anything to fight off the main European countries. But there was one European power who completely supported the idea. England. You should be asking why a country who'd been so colonial hungry just a decade before would be willing to support a baby country telling his elders to stay out. The answer's simple. Money. England had begun the Industrial Revolution and was creating manufactured goods by the thousands, more than it could effectively sell to its own people. So England has products in need of a market. Once these Latin American countries start overthrowing their Spanish colonizers, they're going to need goods. Goods which England is happy to sell them. It was in England's best financial interest to keep these newly freed colonies open and for trade. So, did the Monroe Doctrine actually do anything? Not especially. In practice, the policy failed more often than it succeeded. In 1833, Britain took control of the Falkland Islands off the coast of South America, which broke the policy. So what did the U.S. do? Nothing. I mean, the U.S. had been relying on England to enforce the policy, so what could we do? You can't watch the watchman. In 1862, France, under the leadership of Napoleon III, nephew of that Napoleon, invaded Mexico. The U.S. warned France to stay out of our hemisphere, but there's nothing we could do because we were already in the middle of our own civil war. We literally didn't have the ships or manpower to push back. Plus, we'd have to go through the South to get to Mexico, and the South had already left the Union. That same year, England took over part of Belize and made it a British colony, and once again, we did nothing. Later on, President Ulysses Grant tried to use the doctrine to annex the Dominican Republic in the 1870s, claiming that no territory on this continent, referring to Central and South America, shall be regarded as subject to transfer of European power. In other words, they were going to collect the DR to protect it from Europe. As you can tell by looking at any map of U.S. land, that didn't happen. So, the question should pop up in your head, did the doctrine do anything? In 1898, the U.S. applied the doctrine to help out a newly formed Cuba overthrow its colonial oppressor in Spain. Americans call this the Spanish-American War, the Cubans call it the Cuban War for Independence. If we fast forward about 60 years, we'll see that didn't work out too well for us. The doctrine was used to some success in 1842. We warned England that interfering in Hawaii would constitute an infraction against the policy. England backed off, and the United States annexed Hawaii as a result. An important question is, why does this matter if it didn't do much? As time goes on, the U.S. becomes more and more powerful, and eventually we develop the power to back up our policy. By the 1970s, the U.S. is a world power, and we could intervene. Presidents that came long after Monroe added to the doctrine to keep its life moving forward. Roosevelt added his spin on it with the doctrine of the Roosevelt Corollary. He used it to justify the U.S. being involved in Latin America. He gave a speech to Congress in which he expressed this idea. In the Western Hemisphere, the adherence of the United States to the Monroe Doctrine may force the United States, however reluctantly, in flagrant cases of such wrongdoing or impotence, to the exercise of an international police power. Some presidents have chosen to tone down the doctrine, like when FDR introduced the Good Neighbor Policy with South America. This policy focused more on trade and cooperation to keep the hemisphere stable. And other presidents have chosen to double down on the policy. JFK, for example, chose to lean heavily on this policy while dealing with the Cuban Missile Crisis. With the troubles of the world changing, the reliance on the Monroe Doctrine has died down, and the U.S. has moved its focus from Latin America towards the Middle East. However, the Monroe Doctrine isn't dead. President Trump has mentioned that the Monroe Doctrine could be used to justify military intervention in the turmoil that's going on in Venezuela. Referencing Russia and China's interest in Venezuelan oil production, Trump said, "It's been the formal policy of our country since President Monroe that we reject the interference of foreign nations in this hemisphere." That leads us to the question of the day. How do you think the Monroe Doctrine plays into a world that no longer honors colonization? Let me know what you think down below. This week, we're going to thank Deflect as our Subscriber of the Week. Thanks for watching, and keep it up. If you want to be featured as the Subscriber of the Week, it's easy. Subscribe. Anyway, thanks for watching Learning with Sprayberry, where we try to make social studies fun, easy, and educational. Thanks. Oh, I messed that up.